I mean, my first contact was going to Bharatanatyam class. At the age of 7, I started to train with Pandanallur Subbaraya Pillai. And that was all I did for the first 10 years of my training. After my training in Bharatanatyam, I had not really thought about dance at all. I went to university to study science, and dance was just something I had done as a child. And it was only 4 years later, when I was finishing my master's, I came back to Chennai to do my thesis. And just really by chance, I met Krishna Devanandan, and also a Chandralekha dancer at the time from Kalakshetra. And we were just sort of talking about learning dance as children, and I was saying to her why it wasn't interesting for me beyond the point to see myself as a classical dancer, that I came from a family of doctors and academics, and somehow education, rational education, was what was thought most important. And she had a similar background. And she said, but after I left Kalakshetra, I started to work with Chandralekha, whose name I'd only heard of, but since I hadn't gone to university in Chennai, I didn't know what she was really working on at the time. So she said, just come and watch a rehearsal. This was in 1990, and Chandra had just started to work on the production Shri at the time. And so I just went one evening to the rehearsal space, and it was a very kind of transformative moment for me. Everything that I had struggled with in terms of dance, I felt that she had answered for me and found solutions to, and it attracted me a lot. And Chandra was very open to me immediately starting to work with the company. And so it wasn't sort of a premeditated thought, I have to think about doing something contemporary. It was just something about not only her work, I think her as an artist and her politic, sense of freedom, which I think is still a struggle for women in India, you know, within however progressive one's family thinks it is or might be. And I was attracted to many things that she represented. And so I told my mother that I wanted to do this, and she was surprised, but she didn't prevent it. She said, take a year, do it, and then make a choice between science and dance. And so, yeah, so that's when it started. The nice thing about the relationship with Chandra was it wasn't always smooth or easy or in affirmation. There were difficult moments, and I would then exit the company for a few months or a year, but then return, and she always kept the possibilities open. She didn't hold grudges, however bad the departure was. So right up to 2001, that was when we made, sort of 2000, 2001, that's when I made Sharira with her, but only after very few performances. I had a child by then as well, and I was a single mother. It was becoming, I think, impossible for me to tour without my child, you know, so I quit Sharira too early, I feel. And and then I started to develop my own work. I don't have any sort of formal education in any contemporary technique. So everything that I know, I knew at that moment about working in space with multiple bodies, you know, a lot of these things, that was my formation, those 10 years. But already very early, sort of 3 years into my work with her, I started to develop small work. So this, my first solo, Wings and Masks, was 1993 already work. And I created like this a series of small pieces that I would just perform one time and then not think about it again. And I think that there was something that I felt, I was just thinking the other day, in those years when we began to work, it was never with this idea of having a career or making productions. It was really a thinking about what further can I contribute to this movement towards the contemporary. And I felt in Chandra's work that I missed the personal emotional content that I felt I would like to explore, still somehow through the body, but I felt that in her work there was such a focus on the strong, the powerful, the iconographic imagery, the neutrality of the face, and always somehow this treatment of the body as a part of a larger idea or an image, which was great to be a part of. I mean, I love working in these large collective kind of situations. But at the same time, I felt like I had to, that my body had become so conditioned to just do that one thing. So I started to look, to travel a little bit, to meet practitioners in Europe, not with the idea so much of learning or of adopting those forms, but I started to realize more and more like what that conditioning of my body was, and I wanted to lose it. So I think for almost the first 5 years of my practice, together with Krishna Devanandan, who worked with me for a long time, we were really just looking to unlearn. So this unlearning process was a very important thing for me, because I didn't want to only be able to use my hands in one way and my spine, you know, always in this hyper-arched kind of position. I wanted to a little bit more dig into, yeah, what is the body actually, you know, underneath all the stylistic training, and where are the body's vulnerabilities? And so when I came out in 2000 with my first work, which started to tour internationally, that was called Fragility, was actually a co-production of the Théâtre de la Ville, but they didn't want to show the work for some reasons, I can tell you. But this was a work that was really looking at this, it was a choreography of this unlearning process, you know, like without all of these layers and these strong kind of you know, techniques that we have to show to the world, like what's under all of that when you're just like a human body not allowed to be that strong dancer, you know, who's there. And from there I started to develop the work, I think, in different ways. But I think those years, it was very important for me to also be with Chandra. I mean, because there was no question in my mind that whether as a dancer or as a human being, there was so much to learn. And I didn't want to lose that by just saying, oh, I'm going to be a choreographer. I mean, what was that? It was never this attitude for me. It was always, and there was always this openness. She would come to my rehearsals. Sometimes she would hate what I was doing and she would make it evident. But that was okay for me. It was a part of what had to happen. Yeah. I mean, for me, the real problem is that ideas of contemporary dance are still, the discourse around contemporary dance is still so Eurocentric. Curatorship as well. And I mean, in between the years 2000 and sort of 2008, I think, I mean, every production of mine was playing in Paris at Théâtre de la Ville, because Gérard Violette had the vision to see it and understand the importance of it. Now, where is the next gen? Since he left, I came once to Théâtre de la Ville. Then I was told by Claire that my work was now too radical for the poor French dance society who had never seen anything radical, and she stopped inviting me, stopped even following the work. So, I mean, it's a large conspiracy, if you ask me. It suits everybody in Europe to always have, and I don't want to get too political or acerbic with my comments, but it's a large conspiracy. It's not only about the fact that people seem to love and adore Bharatanatyam, and that, of course, the Ministry of Culture in any India festival will only support the Bharatanatyam dancers, therefore they're able to travel, etc., etc. It's also, for me, it's a very problematic and convenient idea for the West to consider India as sort of an ancient, as a place where ancient traditions live and thrive. Yes, they live and thrive. And they're so complete. Of course, many people, some of the forms, I don't feel Bharatanatyam is, but for some people, evidently. But I think that it's there's a sense of something that needs to be suppressed in a very deliberate way. And I think that unless a new generation of people who are thinking, curating, Simon Dove was one of the rare persons, but we lost him to America. So that Europe's lost. You know, Free Lizen, I think when she was at Kunsten Festival, was one of the most visionary curators, you know, really followed and believed in artists, not an artistic product. But I don't know, when I look around now, I mean, I don't know who's taking these decisions, because we seem to have regressed, you know. Mm-hmm. From the 90s, I feel like we've regressed. Definitely. And the world has closed in. I mean, to be honest, I don't watch Bollywood. My daughter does. So, I mean, I don't dismiss it. I think it's sort of, I think for the youth, it's an important kind of a reference point. I mean, when I was younger, we did watch Tamil cinema. Bollywood wasn't so big, but I mean, you asked me what my first experience of dance, it was really watching MGR films and running around a tree. And at which point my mother said, oh, we'd better just put her in a class. I mean, for me, I don't know. It's sort of it's a problematic gender depiction, I think. I find it fairly ugly and stupid, but I mean, I'm sure there are some good ones. That's all I can say. Yeah, I did some years ago, I did one project with Sasha Waltz. She was invited to Calcutta by the Goethe Institute. I don't know if you can call it collaborative. It was obviously her project, and she invited me and a few dancers to be a part of the project. That was one moment. And I was also a part of the project of David Roland, Stranger in Paradise. But I liked his project, where he proposed an idea and a system within which to create with complete freedom. So until 4 or 5 years ago, I was only performing in theatres. Normally, like, it was a festival, a dance festival, or a theatre programmation, etc. So the work was fairly sort of mainstream. It was just a performance on a stage. When things started to become financially difficult to keep producing new work, I started to work. The first such piece was Wall Dancing, which you saw, which had zero production money. So I don't need to have a lighting designer. There were nothing in terms of costume. Even the sound was all just recycled from old works. And I must say, after I started with Wall Dancing, I find it actually very claustrophobic to go back into a theater space. So after Wall Dancing, I created the piece Varnam, which premiered at the Kochi Biennale. So I've been working more sort of, and finding it interesting to be, to sort of explore a little bit the visual arts world. So Varnam is a, and recently it was also in Korea at the Museum of Contemporary Art. So I like these spaces, museums. Now in Bombay, we're going to play in a gallery. And I prefer that now for me, rather than being sort of in a black box and having to, you know, spend so much time just focusing 10 lights, you know. Yes. This way I'm just quite free. But yeah, there are still always people who want to have something on a stage again.
So. This, I know there have been more festivals, there are more platforms, I think, being established. But for me, I don't find the audience becoming more critical. I mean, critical in a good way, in sense of an audience who comes with reference, you know, with sensibility. In fact, for me, the nicest experience was at the Kochi Biennale, because there were people who are coming to watch the visual arts. And they seem to have at least a way of seeing or a way of reading aesthetics, you know, etc., narrative, which I think the standard performing arts audience often doesn't have. You know, if we're looking at an audience who is used to watching Bharatanatyam, that's problematic. And an audience which is looking for the contemporary seems to me oddly enough aspirational. You know, we're still, our references are all, oh, it has to be flashy, it has to be like, they like Akram Khan, you know, like that's the highest peak you can reach. There doesn't seem to be an audience or a dance population of substantial quantity who's really, as I said, it's all become about careers and products. And I feel we've lost an important layer, which is really doing the years and years of critical research, which to my mind makes good artists and then can insist on good audiences. You can't do it with two or three, you know, artists in one country of this size. So I think that, yeah, we have a long way to go, and I wonder if we'll get there, to be honest. I feel like the whole discourse and narrative has been hijacked in a way to become very like, yeah, the aim is for young dancers today is very often like, how do I make my peace? You know, you work for a very short amount of time, understandable because no one has money, you know, and then the goal seems to be, okay, if we've toured in Europe once or twice, that's fine. Then we go on to the next work. So for me, I really question, yeah, for me, quality, I think, is becoming a problem.
You had a space?
No, we never had a space. We were always the beggars. So we were always going to, we worked at the Alliance Française, as long as the director there was supportive of us. The last couple of years, we've been working more at the Goethe Institute. Sometimes at spaces, Chandra's old space. So wherever, I mean, wherever people were willing to come on board with us, we were working. And yeah, so I think over the years, people became quite busy with their own work and lives. And there was a moment we were hoping that there would be a next generation of people who would sustain it, just put some energy and time and take it into another place. But that didn't happen. And then the four of us who founded it, I think we were just too busy to be regular with it. So it's a little bit stagnant at the moment.
Okay.
First, all these years, whenever anybody has approached me to for a commissioned work or to work with another group of dancers, or to even do a residency outside, I've always said two things, that I must create my work here, that this is the source of the energy which informs the work,
And B, that I'm very committed to working with local dancers because they need what I have to offer. I always thought dancers outside already have everything. What do I have to offer to them? And this was a very strong thought in my mind. But I have felt the last few years that times are changing. There's a sense of rigor that doesn't exist today. When we were working in sort of the height of the touring days, it was five days a week, dancers would come 5 hours a day, and that was the kind of work that we were doing. Now with dancers, they have all their terms and conditions, and they can only come 2 days, you know, and out of the 2 days, for sure, they'll not come on one day. Okay, on the other days, they probably don't have their own personal training either. So I just found over the years, dancers not really being dancers at all, not what I'm looking for, what's exciting. To me, I found myself all the time working in a compromised kind of situation. They're lovely people and they often become very good friends and I enjoy their minds and the conversations and the intelligence. But it can be frustrating to try to create an international quality work when you feel like you're always, like in the last work, Varnam, I wasn't going to dance myself. I had 5 dancers for the work. 1 week before the work premiered, I realized that these 5 aren't going to hold the work at all. And so I jumped in as a dancer and I'm sort of double their age. So what does that say about them? I don't know. So what happened then a couple of years ago is I was invited to China just as a one-off project. And I took it because I was just very curious to go. And so I had sort of 6 or 7 dancers from Beijing. And I had 2 weeks to create a work that would just open in a gallery space. So it was just the starting, but it was something that I found really enjoyable because these dancers were virtuosic. They had amazing training, but they were also very, very sweet and open. And it's not true when people say, oh, they're just robotic, you know. They actually aren't. You know, they were all very unique and individual. And I enjoyed it. And also recently we were together in Cardiff with Preeti and Praveen on a project, worked with students there, and it was a lovely experience. You know, they were still very young, 18 or 19 years old, but they were just, it was almost like they had committed to being dancers. And here I don't find that anymore. Unless they're Bharatanatyam dancers, I feel they're still quite. But when they move out of Bharatanatyam or when they come to the contemporary practice, I don't find that commitment to the body, to training, you know. And so I'm now exploring also for next year another project in Toronto, and I'm trying to propose another one to Korea, and I want to work to see if I can just only do those kinds of things. They would be very site-specific projects and sort of working time of 2 weeks to 3 weeks, because the ideas are always very clear to me and I often have quite simple ideas. I think there have been a few things that I've been carrying. One is the idea of how does one define body, you know, and the research has been sort of ongoing. It's not that I ever found one answer to this question and then I just stopped and I just repeated the same movement pattern. No, it's always for me kind of intriguing, like how deep can one go into the sources of movement, you know, within the body, and you know, how, and through that research, you know, how does one actually create vocabulary for the body? So that's been an ongoing research. I think another thing that I've been, and I'm becoming more and more preoccupied, is sort of, you know, what is this frame? You know, we talk about the body, but we're often less thinking about, you know, how do we situate the body in space? And that's why the site-specific projects are becoming interesting for me, because I like now working in kind of interesting architectural spaces and just working with large images. So I like to create works now with, you know, large groups of dancers. And somehow this, I love to work on the connection within these large groups of dancers, you know, how to time together, you know, certain notions of being precise, not only within the body, but in terms of the body in space. So I think there are some ongoing preoccupations that are now, everything I do now, I seem to be very fascinated by creating these, almost these single large, I don't know if you saw Pushed, did you see? No. So see, I started already with Pushed to create these sort of, almost these chains of bodies. So bodies really connected to become large organic forms. For me there's something metaphysical in the viewing of a large single object that's powered by individual minds that have actually decided to be together. And it's for me a very complex but also very poetic when it happens. And of course there's my ongoing fetish of time, you know, how do we relate time and space? What is that relationship? So I think these are the things. I don't think so much about themes or message per se, but for me there's a lot of meaning in the practice. And it's the meanings are more like, yeah, they're more, I don't want to say philosophical because that can be too intellectual also, but they're just, yeah, very simply, yeah, ideas about, yeah, being and moving and togetherness, I think.
Petka?
Yeah, that's his competition thing. Very bad idea, if you ask me. And this is, again, this whole kind of, you know, this importing and imposition by the West, trying to tell us what to do, how to do it. And people here seem, it's like imperialism all over again, where we welcome it, you know, with open arms. So good luck to us, is all I can say. And the French are quite fully involved with it as well. For me, all dancers have similar problems of never having gone down to the grammar, ever. And that's the way we're training dancers here. It's very superficial. I mean, and Bharatanatyam dancers, yeah, like I said, they know how to do one thing and they can do that very well. But even now, one of my dancers is from Kalakshetra. She's appallingly bad. She has no understanding of her spine. She's so inflexible. She's not strong. She finished 4 years in Kalakshetra, you know. Now I said to her, I can't train you anymore. You better just go to a yoga class and sort yourself out. It's sad, actually. Very sad. Very sad.